Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وأصلي وأسلم على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا وحبيبنا وقرة أعيننا محمد بن عبد الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم أما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في قرآنه العزيز بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وإلى مدين أخاهم شعيبا قال يا قوم اعبدوا الله ما لكم من إله غيره ولا تنقصوا المكيال والميزان ولا تنقصوا المكيال والميزان إني أراكم بخير وإني أخاف عليكم وإني أخاف عليكم عذاب يوم محيط ويا قوم أوفوا المكيال والميزان بالقسط ولا تبخسوا الناس أشياءهم ولا تعثوا في الأرض ولا تعثوا في الأرض مفسدين بقية الله خير لكم إن كنتم مؤمنين بقية الله خير لكم إن كنتم مؤمنين وما أنا عليكم بحفيظ. All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is no doubt our creator, sustainer, nourisher, protector and curer. We ask Him, the Almighty, the Lord of all worlds, the Exalted, to shower His choicest of blessings and salutations upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad salawatu rabbi wa salamuhu alayhi, his family members, his companions and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. First and foremost, it gives me immense pleasure to be here with you all in the beautiful city of Manila in the Philippines. Yesterday we were in Zamboanga, mashallah, another beautiful city. I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses each and every one of you. I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this opportunity, for uniting us together. I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes this gathering, this beautiful gathering, a gathering where the angels shroud us with their wings, the sakina, tranquility of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends upon us. And may He, the Almighty, make high mention of us in the seven heavens. Ameen. Please say ameen. Barakallahu feekum. The topic that has been allocated for me is in regard to a great prophet, a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who was known as Shuayb alayhi salatu wasalam. The ayat that I read at the beginning, at the inception, were ayat related to his story. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He relates His story in the Quran, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has spoken about Prophet Shuayb as well. Prophet Shuayb was sent to the people of Madian. وَإِلَى مَدْيَنَ أَخَاهُمْ شُعَيْبًا. So he was sent to the people of Madian. Now the people of Madian, and you have to understand that Shuayb alayhi salatu wasalam was sent after Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam. He was sent after Hud alayhi salatu wasalam. He was sent after Salih alayhi salatu wasalam. He was sent right after Lut alayhi salatu wasalam. Now as you all might be familiar, Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, what's the distinguishing feature about Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam? And I'm not going to be the only one doing the talking here. He was, yes, true, there's a ship in regard to his story. But in terms of himself. He was the first, what? Messenger to be sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see, our father, Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, I spoke about Adam alayhi salatu wasalam yesterday when I was in Zamboanga. We spoke about in the beginning and we took the audience way back. Now, Adam alayhi salatu wasalam is known as Abul Bashar, the father of mankind, because he was the first creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was a prophet sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was a Nabi sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As for Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, he was a Rasul sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now there is a distinct difference between a Nabi and a Rasul. Now without getting too technical here, I'll elaborate very quickly. A Nabi can be translated as a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whilst a Rasul can be translated as a messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are varying opinions in regard to the difference between the two terms, but you can conclude upon this particular definition, where a Nabi is a prophet of Allah sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with no new revelation. With no new revelation, but rather he follows up on the revelation that is already prevalent and present. Whilst a Rasul is an individual sent by Allah, appointed by Allah with a new revelation. With a new revelation. You take Musa, a good example to highlight the difference. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam and his brother Harun alayhi salatu wasalam. Now Musa alayhi salatu wasalam was a Rasul, and a point to be remembered is if an individual is a Rasul, by default he is a Nabi as well. So Musa alayhi salatu wasalam was a Rasul, whilst Harun alayhi salatu wasalam, his brother, was only a Nabi. Why? Because Musa alayhi salatu wasalam was given what? Torah. He was given a revelation, a divine revelation by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whilst Harun, alayhi salatu wasalam, his own brother, was not given a new revelation, but rather he was following up on the revelation of Musa, alayhi salatu wasalam. And from this we understand that at one time, a prophet and a rasul can be sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You take Sulaiman, alayhi salatu wasalam, and Dawood, alayhi salatu wasalam. You have two prophets at the same time. So coming back to the definitions now, you have to understand that every rasul is a nabi, but not every nabi is a rasul. Every Rasul is a Nabi, not every Nabi is a Rasul. Like every crow is black, but not every black is a crow. Did I lose you all? Every crow is black, but not every black is a crow. You're wearing a black t-shirt, mashallah, it's not a crow. Your hair is black, it's not a crow. But then there are reports to state that you do find some white crows, but it's a rare occurrence. Anyway, in general, we go with what's, you know, prevalent. Every crow is generally black. So every Rasul is a Nabi, but not every Nabi is a Rasul. So Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam was the first Rasul to be sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then you have other prophets who were sent by Allah azza wa jal. And after Lut alayhi salatu wasalam comes about Shuayb alayhi salatu wasalam. And he was sent to the people of Madian. Now the people of Madian, they were a people who used to worship a tree called Aika. Or a thicket. They used to worship a thicket. They were people who used to worship other things, other objects along with Allah, or they had completely forgotten Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And another heinous crime that this particular group of individuals or this nation was committing at that time was that they used to play around with weights and measures. When they used to trade, they were heavily involved in trade, and they would play around with their weights and measures in the sense, say for example, if they had to sell something for 1 pound or 1 kilo, they would sell perhaps 750 grams or 800 grams. They would reduce and play around with the weights and measures, and they would charge people inappropriately. And that was not the only thing that they used to commit. There were also individuals who used to behave like bandits. They would wait and look for caravans that were passing through the city of Madian, and they would target those caravans. They would rob those caravans, they would strip those caravans of those belongings. They were highway robbers, if you will. And Shu'aib alayhi salatu wasalam was appointed and sent to this nation to rectify their condition. And Allah mentions in Surah Hud, the ayat that I read at the beginning, that he went to them repeatedly and kept reminding them about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this was generally the mission of the prophets alayhimu salatu wasalam. They were sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala whenever mankind would drift away and forget Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Prophets were sent to remind them, to rectify their conditions, to change, to turn over a new leaf. So Shuayb alayhi salatu wasalam, he went to them and he kept imploring, he kept reminding them of the nations of the past in regard to what happened to them, like for example the nation of Lut alayhi salatu wasalam and the nations of the past. He kept reminding them, but to no avail. All of that fell on deaf ears. They made a mockery out of Shuayb alayhi salatu wasalam, because he was a very eloquent prophet. In the sense, he was very good with words. He was very eloquent, very articulate. But in terms of his physique, he was a weak individual. He had a very thin figure and he was a weak individual, but he was very articulate with his words. So they would make fun of him in regard to his weakness, in regard to his weak physique. They would make fun of him. They would make a mockery out of him. They would make a mockery out of his warnings, out of his reminders, out of his invitations that he was calling them towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But he tried hard, just as every prophet did, he tried hard to bring his nation, to bring his people back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but they did not listen. And they kept challenging him. Oh, so you're warning us about something, let that come true. Bring about your prophecy, you're prophesying something, bring about it. Your prophecy, bring it. We want to see it. We want to witness it. And they kept taunting him. They kept challenging him. And he kept warning them. He kept warning them. He kept telling them, turn back to Allah. Seek Allah's forgiveness. Turn to Him in sincere repentance. But they never ever listened. And they kept transgressing the limits of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They kept indulging in oppression. They became oppressors. They started to spread, cause mischief and corruption on the face of this earth. Until finally Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decides to punish this nation. Allah azza wa jal mentions in that same context, وَلَمَّا جَاءَ أَمْرُنَا نَجَّيْنَا شُعَيْبًا وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مَعَهُ بِرَحْمَةٍ مِنَّا وَلَمَّا جَاءَ أَمْرُنَا. And when our matter came, or rather when our matter was decreed, najjayna shu'ayba, we saved Shu'ayb, walladhina amanu ma'ahu, and those who had believed with him, i.e. his family. No one else had believed in Shu'ayb alayhi salatu wasalam. So Shu'ayb alayhi salatu wasalam and his family was saved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah goes on to describe the punishment that was inflicted upon the people of Medina. And I want you all to pay an attentive ear. وَأَخَذَتِ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا الصَّيْحَةَ فَأَصْبَحُوا فِي دِيَارِهِمْ جَاهَثِمِينَ. What happened was, as per the words of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there was this heat that started, a scorching heat. They could not bear it. They could not tolerate it. And they thought it had something to do with the weather. They kept going out and looking at the heavens, looking at the clouds. It was so hot, unbearable heat, scorching heat. And in this situation, some of them noticed a dark cloud approaching. A cloud that looked promising to them. And they thought, ah, rain is approaching. And they kept yearning and waiting for this cloud. The cloud made its way. And as it approached a certain location, the people of Median, they all ran to the cloud, to the shade of the cloud, to drench themselves in perhaps the rain that they were all expecting. But what happened? They go, all of them, and they stand under the cloud, only to witness the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where thunderbolts started to come crashing down, where the anger of Allah azza wa jal started to come down. And now they were trembling, they were scared, they remember the reminder of their brother Shu'aib alayhi salatu wasalam. But now it's too late. Now the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had approached them and had descended upon them. Now they run back. They try to run back to the safety of their homes. And as they run back, the earth starts to tremble. And they started to witness earthquakes. And as they made their way into their homes, there was this loud shriek. As Allah mentions, وَأَخَذَتِ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا الصَّيْحَةَ. There was this صَيْحَةَ, this loud shriek. A sound, unbearable sound. It was almost as if their eardrums were about to burst into pieces. They hear this shriek and they became transfixed and paralyzed in their locations. Subhanallah. Think about it. And they were killed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, completely obliterated from the face of this earth due to their transgression, due to their oppression. In summary, this is the story of the nation of Shuayb alayhi salatu wasalam. He was bestowed with many signs, many miracles, as in general the prophets of Allah are bestowed upon. And he put forth all these signs, but they refused to believe in him. And the point that I want to deduce here, because see, the thing is, there are many lessons that can be deduced and derived from the story of Shuayb alayhi salatu wasalam. The point that I want to highlight, okay, is the fact that even though they were indulging in so much of sin, so much of transgressions, he kept telling them one piece of advice, and that was, وَاسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ ثُمَّ تُوبُوا إِلَيْهِ إِنَّ رَبِّي رَحِيمٌ وَدُودٌ وَاسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ. Seek the forgiveness of your Lord. Istighfar is upon the scale istaf'ala yastaf'ilu in the Arabic language, which means to seek something. Istighfar means to seek forgiveness. Isti'adha, to seek the protection of Allah. Isti'dhan, to seek permission. Istifham, to seek an understanding. So, wastaghfiru rabbakum, seek the forgiveness of your Lord. Thumma tubu ilayh, and turn back to him in tawbah. Inna rabbi rahimu wadud. Indeed, my Lord is Rahim, is Wadood. Rahim in the sense is most merciful. He is the especially merciful, the most merciful. Wadood, and the most caring, the most loving. He kept repeating this message to them. He kept telling them that, look, you know that you have transgressed the limits of Allah. You know that you have sinned. You know that you have indulged in oppression, but yet Allah is willing to forgive you. All you have to do is take the initiative, put your foot forward, and turn back to him in sincere tawbah. Turn over a new leaf. And if you turn back to him sincerely seeking his forgiveness, Allah the Almighty will most definitely forgive you. And this is the lesson that I want to highlight, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam. Think about it. You and I, we too, we are constant and perpetual sinners who keep transgressing the limits of Allah, at times in small ways and at times in big ways. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us all. But we all have to bear in mind that our Maker subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most forgiving, the most merciful. And this is the central message that I have to share with you all today. Each time you open up the Quran, what do you read after isti'adha? Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. In the name of Allah, the most angry, the one who is full of punishments. Is that how we start off the Quran each time you open up the Quran? In the name of Allah, the entirely merciful, the especially merciful. In the name of Allah, the most beneficent, the most merciful. Each time you open up the Quran. And how many a time do we come across in the Quran that Allah is Ghafoor, Allah is Rahim. Allah himself describes himself in the Quran where he states, نَبِّعْ عِبَادِي أَنِّي أَنَا الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tell them, tell your nation that indeed I am the most forgiving, the most merciful. And then there's a beautiful balance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strikes in the very next ayah, where he goes on to describe himself and he states, وَأَنَّ عَذَابِي هُوَ الْعَذَابُ الْأَلِيمُ. And tell them that my punishment is indeed a painful torment. And this is why, as believers, we need to balance the hope that we have in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the fear that we have for the punishment of Allah azza wa jal. You see, at times we think of Allah, some people think of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as some kind of a war god. They think of Allah azza wa jal as being angry all the time. And they fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But that should not be the case, because Allah in that ayah says, he introduces and describes himself by saying, I am the most forgiving, the most merciful. And then he goes on to say, my punishment, tell them my punishment is most severe, most painful. He doesn't talk about himself. So we need to fear his punishment. And we need to love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The more we love Allah azza wa jal, the more we get closer to him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you know something that's amazing about the fear that we have for the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or if you want to say the fear of Allah azza wa jal, the concept of taqwa. You know what's amazing? Can I ask you all something? If you fear something, all right, and if that object of fear were to enter this particular venue, what would you do? Are you scared of lions? No? MashaAllah. Filipinos are very brave. I'm petrified. Are you scared of snakes? Slithery snakes? Like if a ton of snakes were to make their way inside here, al-iyadu billah, may Allah save us all. We would all run, helter-skelter. Why? Because the object of fear has manifested itself. Yes or no? What do? When we see something that we fear, we run away from it. But in regard to the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more you fear Him, the more you do what? You run towards Him, subhanallah. The more you run towards Him. You don't run away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the amazing thing about the love that we have for Allah azza wa jal, which is something I will touch on briefly towards the end. Okay? Anyway, coming back to the concept of tawbah, you have to know that whatever the sin may be that you have committed, Allah is the most forgiving, the most merciful. The only thing that He will not tolerate is shirk, and that is if you die upon the fold of shirk. Even shirk, if you turn to Him before you die and make tawbah, Allah will forgive that too. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَن يَشَاءُ. Allah will not forgive shirk. That is, if you die upon the fold of shirk, where you die associating partners unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But apart from that, everything else, Allah azza wa jal is the most forgiving, the most merciful. And there are a few conditions that you need to fulfill in regard to tawbah, very quickly. The first condition being that you need to regret. Nadam. You need to regret. Now see, Shuayb alayhi salatu wasalam was telling them, turn back to Allah. If you turn back to Him, He's going to forgive you. You can mend your ways. You can get closer to Him. You can win the love of Allah Azza wa Jal. But they refused to turn to Allah, resulting in them being obliterated and destroyed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Coming back to the conditions of tawbah, the first condition is nadam, where you regret deeply. Deep within you need to regret that, oh, I've committed something wrong. I have displeased Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I have transgressed the limits of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That deep regret has to fill and permeate your heart. The minute you have that regret, shaitan, he starts to, you know, feel very upset, because he knows that now you're feeling guilty. You're going to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why when you study his protocol, he actually prefers people who indulge in innovations over people who are in major sins. You know why? Because someone who is committing a major sin like indulging in zina, indulging in interest-bearing transactions, etc., which are all from the kaba'ir, those individuals will feel guilty. Oh, you know what? I'm displeasing Allah. I need to mend my ways. I need to turn over a new leaf. I need to come out of this illicit relationship. I need to come out of this interest-bearing transaction. But someone who is indulging in innovations, that individual is never ever going to feel guilty. You know why? Because he feels, oh, what I'm doing is something to get closer to Allah, is something to get closer to prove my love for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But whilst we clearly know, kulla bida'atin dhalala wa kulla dhalalatin finnar, every innovation is a misguidance and every misguidance is in the fire of Jahannam. Shaitan has a very strategic protocol that he follows. Time does not permit to go into it. But he knows, the minute someone feels guilty, they are bound to turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the first condition of tawbah, where you feel nadam, deep guilt from within, that you want to turn over a new leaf. And then right after that, you need to move into the next condition. And that is al-iqla'. You need to come out of that sin quickly. If you are in an illicit relationship, come out of it. If you are in an extramarital affair, come out of it. If you are addicted to pornography, come out of it. If you are in an interest-bearing transaction, come out of it. Come out of the sin completely. This is the second condition of tawbah. Al-iqla' ani dhunub. You need to come out of that sin completely. And then the third condition, al-azm, where you have to have firm determination that you will not go back to that sin ever again. You need to have firm determination. These are conditions related to tawbah and nasuha, a true and sincere tawbah. You have to come out of it. See, we have a beautiful story that has been recorded in the books of hadith. It's an authentic story where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is reported to have told us about a man who did what? Who killed, who assassinated 99 individuals. I'm sure most of you are aware of the story. It's a reminder at the end of the day. He killed 99 individuals and now he feels guilty. He's a serial killer. 99 individuals. Subhanallah. And now he wants to turn over a new leaf. He goes to someone and he asks him, a monk if I'm not mistaken, he goes and he tells him, look, I've killed 99 individuals. Is there any hope for me? Will God forgive me? Can I turn over a new leaf? The monk looks at him and says, 99 people and you think God is going to forgive you? There's no way that you can attain the forgiveness of God. The man becomes enraged and he slits the throat of this man as well, totaling the number up to 100 now. 100 people done. It's one century. But still he feels guilty even after that. Why did I do it? And now he goes to a learned individual. He goes to the learned individual and tells him the story. I initially had killed 99 people. And then I went to someone. And that person said that, you know what? There's no forgiveness for you. I killed him too. And now I have a total of 100. Will God forgive me? Now this is a learned person. He knew that if I tell him no, I'm going to become 101. That's not mentioned in the hadith anyway. He tells him, but I, you know what? I think that must have obviously gone through his head. He tells him, of course. And this was based on his knowledge. Because he knew that Allah is the most forgiving. He said, of course, why not? Allah is forgiving. Who are we to judge at the end of the day? He is the best of judges. But I will advise you to do something. And he tells him, you are upon the land of sin. You have killed 99 individuals on this particular land. I will advise you to go to a particular land. There's another land that's filled with righteous people who are constantly worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Go to that land, go to those people, spend time with them, be in the right company. See, there are a number of lessons that can be deduced. We can talk about, you know, hanging out with the right people because at the end of the day, your company defines who you are and things like that. But anyway, what I want to highlight is something else, so I'll come to that inshallah. So he tells him, go to that land, spend time with these people and mend your ways, turn over a new leaf. The man, the murderer, he contemplates, he thinks, you know what, it's not such a bad idea after all. And at the end of the day, from this we understand that he's sincere because look, he's telling him to leave a land, basically make migration. He's going to leave everything and go. He's sincere. He's determined that he wants to turn over a new leaf. What he does is he packs up everything and he leaves that land and now he's headed to the other land. And the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala works in amazing ways. It was decreed that the angel of death should visit him whilst he was on his journey. Now as you all might be aware, the angel of death in general does not come alone. As per the words of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he is accompanied by a team. And all these angels come to an individual in a very pleasant and beautiful form if the soul is a beautiful soul. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make our endings beautiful. Ameen. As for a sinner, as for an evil individual, the angels also come in a very horrifying and scary form. Now two teams of angels descend to extract or take the soul of this man. And who are these two teams? The good team and the scary team. And now there's a conflict, if you will, between these two teams as to which team should take the soul of this man. The team that generally handles the good souls say, he is a man who killed, yes, but now he is on his way to make tawbah. And he's a good soul. We should take his soul. Whilst the other team says, how? This man, he killed 100 people. He's a serial killer. We need to take his soul. And then an angel comes down in the form of a mediator to offer a solution. He says, let me offer a solution. Why don't the two teams measure the land? And this is not something difficult for the angels at the end of the day. Why don't you all measure the land? And if you find the man closer to the land of sin, let the angels who handle evil souls take his soul. If on the other hand, you find him closer to the land of goodness, the land of forgiveness, the land of righteousness, then let the angels who handle good souls take his soul. They think about it, seems to be a good solution. Let's measure the land. They measure the land and lo and behold, they find the man closer, wait for it, to the land of goodness. And the angels who handle good souls, they swiftly take his soul and move away. There are scholars who commentate in this regard and they say, the man had just commenced his journey. And in all likelihood, there is a strong possibility that the man could have been closer to the land of evil, the land of sin. But out of the sheer and infinite mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He folded the land and made sure the man was closer to the land of goodness. Subhanallah. Look at the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it was because of the sincerity of this man. He had regret. Iqla', he came out of the sin and he was determined not to go back to the sin. He was fulfilling the conditions of tawbah. And there is a final condition. And this condition is that the tawbah needs to occur before two things. One, before the angel of death comes and stands in front of you. Before your soul reaches a point known as gharghara, where it reaches your collarbones. Once your soul reaches your collarbones, you will basically witness everything. The veils will be lifted and you will see this world for its reality. And then it's too late. If you try to cry out to Allah in tawbah, your tawbah will not be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Fir'aun, the tyrant, the oppressor, he did so. He was drowning. He witnessed everything. And now he cries out, إِنِّي آمَنْتُ بِرَبِّ هَارُونَ وَمُوسَى. I now believe in the Lord of Harun and Musa. But that was not accepted. Why? Because he was at the brink of death. He was at the point of gharghara. So before the angel of death comes and stands in front of you, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, and that wallahi can happen any time. You know, just last week, before I came in here, my Jum'ah sermon, I spoke about something related to death because in my country, there were three tragic deaths that took place within just 1 week. One was the death of a very prominent and senior local scholar who passed away in his 80s. The other death was a family that's close to me, a senior member of the family, the father of the family, a very loving member of the family. He passed away at the age of 50 years if you will. And the last tragic incident was the death of a very young individual in the prime of life. He was furthering his studies in the United Kingdom. A very promising career ahead of him. He died in his 20s. All within 1 week. Now look at these three tragic incidents. What do you notice? 80s, 50s, 20s. What do you notice? The angel of death can come to you at any time. The million dollar question, are you prepared to meet the angel of death? Are you prepared to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What if, before you go out of these doors, the angel of death comes to you? The words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you can't even guarantee life. From one salam to the other salam, subhanallah. No guarantee. But look at how much of time, how much of effort, how much of resources we are putting into investing in this life, whilst we know that at the very most we are going to live for only about 60 to 70 years. But we're not investing for the life of the hereafter where we're going to live forever and ever, an eternity. Do you know what eternity means? An infinity. It never ends basically. Remember, always remember this. I repeat this often. The only sighs of regret of the dwellers of Jannah will be that, oh, I should have said one more Subhanallah. I should have said one more Alhamdulillah. I should have said one more Allahu Akbar. I should have said one more La ilaha illallah wahdah. La sharika lah. Lahul mulk wa lahul hamd. Wa huwa ala kulli shayin qadir. I should have said one more Subhanallah wa bihamdih. Subhanallah al-azim. A tree would be planted in my gardens of paradise. A mansion would have been built for me in paradise. I would be upon another level in paradise. Subhanallah. Because in paradise, you won't be able to invest for your paradise. This is where you need to invest. You need to plant the seeds here and you will harvest them in the hereafter, insha'Allah ta'ala. May Allah Azza wa Jalla open the doors of Jannah for all of us. Ameen. So my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, coming back to tawbah, it is important that we turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in sincere tawbah before it's too late. That's number one. Before the angel of death comes in front of you. Okay? And the next condition, or rather the second part of the final condition, is before the sun rises from the west. It is from the major signs of the day of Qiyamah that the sun will rise from the west. Currently it rises from where? The north? Where does it rise from? The east. Contrary to that, it will rise from the west. And the minute it rises from the west, now think of it, it's going to be a great phenomenon. One day you're going to wake up, because see, for the sun to rise from the west, things, a lot of things have to change. Our orbit needs to change, so many things have to change. You wake up and it'll be pitch black, pitch darkness. Wallahu alam, even the satellites may come crashing down. You may grab your phone to check your news feed, it won't be working. And then you'll think to yourself, okay, the sun has not risen, or rather it's going to rise from the west. And then you decide to cry out to Allah, oh Allah, forgive me. Your tawbah will not be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can cry tears of blood, but the doors of tawbah will be slammed shut. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us all to turn back to him before it's too late. Ameen. So my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, it's important that we turn over a new leaf. Even if you don't take anything from me today, take this. Turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before it's too late. Intend right now that you know whatever I've done, put it behind you. And think, I am going to turn over a new leaf. Allah is the most forgiving, the most merciful. I am going to seek His forgiveness. And Allah Azza wa Jal will most definitely forgive you, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam. I'm going to share a beautiful narration with you all. It's such a beautiful and emotional narration of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. It has been recorded in the book of Imam Muslim, Rahimahullah. Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he mentions this particular narration. And this narration talks about the last person to enter Jannah, the last person to enter paradise. Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he mentions that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, and the hadith goes along the lines of these words, the last person to enter paradise will cross as-sirat. Now that's an ordeal that we have to deal with. May Allah ease that for us. It's going to be such a scary ordeal because that bridge, that sirat, is going to be finer and thinner than a hair and sharper than a sword, with thorns all over. There will be people who will cross it in the twinkling of an eye. There will be people who will cross it like a lightning bolt. There will be people who will cross it like a gust of wind. There will be people who will cross it like galloping upon a horse, like galloping upon a camel. There will be people who will cross it running. There will be people who will cross it walking. There will be people who will cross it crawling. There will be people who will cross it dragging themselves. And there will be people who will cross it, but they will not cross it. They will fall right into Jahannam. May Allah save us all. This man, the last person to enter Jannah, think about it. The last individual to enter Jannah will cross as-sirat. He will stumble. He will fall. He will be at the brink of falling into Jahannam. And Jahannam, deep down, it's in all its darkness, in all its fury, writhing and roaring away. I want you all to imagine the scene. I want you all to imagine this hadith. Think of the hadith as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam narrating the hadith to you. He struggles and he makes his way through the bridge, scratching himself, hurting himself, injuring himself. And somehow he makes it to the other side. And he praises Allah, Alhamdulillah. Because you see, if you make it to the other side, you're saved. You're saved. You are going to make it into Jannah. So he makes it to the other side. He stumbles and makes it to the other side, and he praises Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But he does not know that he's going to go into paradise. He turns back, he looks at the bridge, and he praises Allah, Alhamdulillah. Allah, you saved me from it. I think I am the most fortunate of individuals ever. The last person to enter paradise. He thinks this and he moves forward. And then suddenly he spots a tree. A tree, not like a tree that is planted in this world. Not a mango tree, not an apple tree. A tree of paradise planted by who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A tree so beautiful that as per the description, a rider, a fast rider, would have to gallop for 100 years to cover the shade of one tree of paradise. Subhanallah. He sees this beautiful tree and he prays to Allah. Oh Allah, how I wish to go by that tree and just sit down by the shade of that tree. It's so hot. And I've just crossed the bridge. I just want to make it to that tree and sit down by the tree. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now addresses the slave by saying, oh my slave, oh the son of Adam, what are you asking me of? And if I were to answer this dua of yours, will you ask anything else of me? To which the man excitedly replies, no, ya Allah, I promise I will not ask anything else. I just want to make it to that tree. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers the dua. And the man stumbles and runs to the shade of that tree. He falls by the shade of that tree. And he starts to drink of the water by that tree. And he's enjoying in the shade of that tree. Then suddenly, he notices another tree that is even more beautiful, even more bigger. And then he cries out, oh Allah, can I please make it to that tree? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks at him. O son of Adam, you just promised that you will not ask anything of me. And now here you are asking something else. Will you promise me that you will not ask anything of me if I were to answer this dua of yours? The man again excitedly says, O Allah, I promise you, I will not ask you anything else. Allah answers his dua and he makes it to that tree, the more beautiful tree now. And then he makes it there, he notices another tree. Now this tree is by the gate of paradise. And now he looks there and is wondering, I promised. O Allah, can I make it to that tree? Again Allah says, O my slave, you promised me, you took a covenant that you will not ask me anything. And now here you are, you're asking me something else. And he grants that dua as well, he makes it to that tree. And now, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, he notices what? The people of paradise. Through the gates of Jannah, he can hear the people of paradise. He can hear their laughter. He can hear their merrymaking. And his heart yearns for Jannah. His heart yearns for paradise. He prays to Allah, O Allah, can I please be granted entry into paradise? To which Allah replies, our beloved Maker, the most forgiving, the most merciful. He tells him, my slave, did you not take a covenant? Did you not promise me that you will not ask of me anything? Will you stop asking me if I were to give you a Jannah, a paradise that is equivalent to dunya and double it? The man cries unto Allah, O Allah, are you making fun of me, Ya Allah? Are you making a mockery out of me? And then at that point, Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he smiles. He smiles, fadahik, he laughs. And then he looks at the people around him and he tells them, will you not ask me why I'm laughing, why I'm smiling? And just as how Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu smiled and laughed, I too am smiling and laughing because you know why? Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu went on to say, when Muhammad salawatu rabbi wa salamuhu alayhi was narrating the hadith to us, he too smiled and he laughed. How I envy the companions of the Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam. Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majman. How I envy them that they could see Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam smile and laugh. Just imagine what a beautiful sight that must have been. And they all asked him, Ya Rasulullah, why are you smiling? Why are you laughing? And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went on to explain, I'm smiling and laughing because the minute the man says that, oh Allah, you're making fun of me, Allah the Almighty, the Lord of all worlds will smile and laugh kama yaliqu bi sha'nihi wa jalalihi, in a manner that befits his majesty and glory. When we say smile and laugh, we don't mean like us, because laysa kamithlihi shay, there's nothing in comparison to Allah, but Allah will laugh and Allah will smile. And then he will tell his slave, oh my slave, I am not making a mockery out of you. I can do whatever I want to do. Subhanallah. Look at the narration. And look at the mercy. Look at the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at how kind Allah azza wa jalla is. The last person to enter Jannah. I want you all to think about it. The last person. Akhir rajul, the last person to enter Jannah will be given a Jannah that is equivalent to dunya. And double it, subhanallah. Look at how generous Allah is, how merciful Allah is. So if you were to think that, you know what, I've committed so many sins that Allah will not forgive me, that thought of yours needs a separate tawbah. The fact that you're thinking that Allah will not forgive you, you need to make a separate tawbah for that. Because Allah is the most forgiving, the most merciful. And to put all of this in perspective, in the few minutes that I have with you all remaining, we have to add something. And that is the love for Allah and His beloved Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you want to be victorious, if you want to be successful in this world as well as the hereafter, you need to love Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And how do you love Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Allah says in the Noble Quran, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ يحببكم الله ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم والله غفور رحيم. Say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tell the Sahaba, and by extension tell your ummah, that is you and I, إن كنتم تحبون الله, if you love Allah, فاتبعوني, then follow me. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying this, follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and you know what you will get in return? يحببكم الله. Allah will love you in return. Just imagine, if Allah loves you, what more do you need? If, for example, if you were to say, the king of a particular place or the president of the country, he loves me, you'd be like, call us all up, mashallah. You'd be like a VIP. Think about it. Allah, the Lord of the heavens, the Lord of all worlds, is loving you. If you follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and doesn't end there, the package doesn't end there. وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ, and Allah will forgive you all your sins. وَاللَّهُ غَفُورُ رَحِيمُ, Allah is the most forgiving, the most merciful. And when we look at the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, they loved Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam like no one else, subhanallah. None of us can ever claim to love him more than the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in. Two incidents very quickly. During the Battle of Badr, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was aligning the rows of the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in. He was aligning their rows. Okay. There was a companion by the name Sawad ibn Ghaziyah radiyallahu an. He observes the situation. He knows what a crucial juncture this is. He knows that we are going to go into battle and we may not return back. It was such a crucial juncture because the Battle of Badr, the Muslimun were how many? 300 odd. Just 300 odd. Whilst the pagans were 1,000 strong, armed to the teeth. They had weaponry, they had animals, they had swords, they had all kinds of things. Muslimun, they had nothing. They were outnumbered. They were badly outnumbered. And they knew it was a crucial juncture, but the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was imminent, but still it was a crucial juncture. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as was his general practice, he was aligning the rows because he was a very disciplined individual, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a very systematic individual. He was aligning the rows. He was teaching the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in to align the rows. And this is very interesting because even in salah, what do? We align rows. We don't look at salah from that angle, but if you look at it, it's actually a programming of yourself to make you more disciplined, to make you more orderly, to make you more organized. And that's why the imam every single day, what does he say? Istawu wa'tadilu, sawu sufufakum, hadu bayn al-manakibi wal-aqdam, straighten your rows, fill up the gaps, come forward, make sure that the rows are in alignment. We strive, because the thing is, we don't look at salah from that angle and we don't activate that programming, and that's why we tend to spend a lot of time in terms of aligning our rows in salah, but outside our cars are parked helter skelter. You go outside the masjid and look at how we arrange our slippers, mashallah, slippers are all over the place, but inside the masjid, oh brother, make sure that your toe is next to my toe, trample the toe. We do all of that, but we don't look at it from the proper angle to deduce the lessons and activate the programming that is found within salah. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam anyway was aligning the rows, and this particular companion, he observes the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam coming, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had a stick with him, a stick to make sure that the rows, not to beat the companions, but to make sure that the rows were in alignment. Sawad ibn Ghaziyah radiallahu anhu observes Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam making his way, and you know what he does? Intentionally, he moves forward. Intentionally, now if this is the row, I don't want to move forward, but I'll fall obviously. There was this row, so he moves forward, and his chest was protruding whilst everybody else was in alignment. Rasulullah makes his way, and Rasulullah at the end of the day had a very good eyesight. He notices Sawad being off in terms of alignment. He goes to him and lightly taps him with the stick that he had on his hand, on his chest. Ya Sawad, istawu, straighten the row. The minute that stick touched Sawad radiallahu anhu, he cries out in pain. He says, Ya Rasulullah, you hurt me. The Sahaba ta'ala alayhi majma'in, they wonder, what's wrong with Sawad? I mean, it was just a mere tap or a touch. Why on earth is he being so dramatic and overreacting? Sawad radiallahu anhu says, no, you hurt me. And you are the most just, you are the most fair, I want to retaliate. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looks at Sawad radiallahu anhu in surprise. And then he tells him, okay, fine. If that's what you want, here's the stick. Go ahead, retaliate. Now Sawad radiallahu anhu was bare-bodied. His upper body was bare. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had on clothing or he had on an armor. So he looks at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and says, Ya Rasulullah, the retaliation will not be fair because I was not clothed, or rather I was bare-bodied whilst you are wearing an armor or clothing. Remove your upper garment. The Sahaba were furious now. What on earth is Sawad doing? This is such a crucial juncture. We are about to go into battle and here he is fidgeting over this petty matter, this trivial issue. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam calms them down and he removes his upper garment, exposing his blessed body. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, no sooner Sawad radiallahu anhu sees the upper body of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he drops the stick and he runs to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He hugs him tightly and he starts to kiss him on his stomach and his chest. Allahu Akbar. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looks at Sawad and says, Ya Sawad, why are you doing this? And Sawad radiallahu anhu, he says, it's a tear-jerking moment. He says, Ya Rasulullah, I know it's a crucial juncture. We're going to go into battle and I may not return. And if I am not to return, I want the last skin that touches me and my lips be your skin, Ya Rasulullah. Look at the love. Look at the love. Can we ever compare our love to the love of the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in towards Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? And it was because of this love that they became the most victorious, the most successful of individuals in both worlds. Radiallahu anhum wa radu an. They were pleased with Allah and Allah is pleased with them. After the demise of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was the muadhin of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Who? Bilal radiallahu an, a great companion. He would find it so difficult. Because see, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away, Medina was in darkness. The city of lights, Madinatul Munawwara, was in darkness after the loss of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Bilal radiallahu anhu literally found it so difficult to call out the adhan. Each and every time he would try to call out the adhan, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, he would break down. He would not be able to continue the adhan. You know why? Because he started to remember Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Memories of Muhammad salawatu rabbi wa salamu alayhi, my mother, my father and myself be ransomed and sacrificed for him. His memories would flood the heart and the mind of Bilal radiallahu anhu. Each time Bilal radiallahu anhu would try to call out the adhan, the people of Medina would all come out clamoring, weeping and crying, thinking of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This was the love that they had for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Where are we in comparison? We are nothing. But at the end of the day, we are the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In comparison, we are nothing. But yet, we have to yearn for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The love that we have for him has to manifest where we completely follow his sunnah. Because his lifestyle, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, is the lifestyle that will secure success for you in this world as well as the hereafter. And if you love Allah, who is the creator of love, the fountain of love, the pinnacle of love, the way to prove that love is by following Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and most definitely each and every one of you will be victorious in this world and the hereafter. And to start that off, you should commence by turning over a new leaf, obtaining a new slate from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a new lease to your life, commence a new chapter. So think of this event, think of this convention, think of this conference as the beginning of a new chapter in your lives. And as you make your way out of these doors, after listening to the mashayikh, the speakers, the scholars, after listening to all their reminders, all their pieces of advice, their reminders from the Quran and the Sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, keep a strong intention in your heart that today, come what may, I am going to turn over a new leaf. I am going to patch up things with my friends, my relatives, with my family members, with my parents if you will, and completely turn over a new leaf, turn to Allah. Whatever I've done wrong, I'm going to seek the forgiveness of everybody, and I'm going to seek the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and get this brand new lease to my life, and start off afresh with a clean and pure heart that is filled with the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If your heart is filled with love for Allah, nothing else will be able to penetrate into your heart and contaminate your pure heart. And that heart will be the heart that will benefit you on the day of Qiyamah, as Allah says in the noble Quran, and I will cap off with that. يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَهَلٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. A day when your children will not benefit you, your wealth will not benefit you, the only thing that will benefit you on the day of Qiyamah will be a sound and healthy heart. Now am I talking about a heart that is free from cardiovascular diseases? A heart that's free from cholesterol perhaps? Maybe I should go to the gym and do some cardio to have a healthy heart to succeed on the day of Qiyamah? No, I'm talking about a spiritual heart that is free from spiritual diseases. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us all to work on our hearts, help us all to purify our hearts. May Allah azza wa jal help us to turn over a new leaf before it's too late. Please say ameen. May He subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive each and every one of us here. May He accept all of us. And just as how He unites us here in this beautiful venue, in this beautiful city, may He unite us in the gardens of Jannah with our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Ameen. Wa akhir da'wah yani alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. With that I conclude. Jazakumullahu khaira wa salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And I hope to see you all in the future as well, inshallah, for many more events. So until then, take care. I love you all for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Jazakumullahu khair. Barakallahu feekum.